begin by saying we're joining the school of the word. And we're still in the school of the word. Because this is, we've set a criterion. We're just going to believe the word.
Amen.
You know, 2 Timothy 3:16. I mean, all of this is declared. I mean, this is when we started. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Say it again. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Or it's God on me. Every scripture. You can't, and listen, let me tell you something. I'll give you another one. Proverbs 30 verse 5 says the word of God is pure. That's Proverbs 30 verse 5. The word of God is pure. And blessed are those who put their trust in Him and in His word. So, you can rely on the word. There's a lot of things that are being put out there today. You can't put your hope in them. I mean, I received Social Security, but my hope is not in Social Security.
Amen.
My hope isn't in the American government to always have money to pay me, so whatever they've agreed to pay me. My hope's not there. My hope is in the Lord. My hope is in the Word.
Amen.
And that's where we've got to keep our hope so that we're not at all alarmed with what things can come up. But one of the things that we got into last week was understanding healing. And understanding that healing is something that has been assured. In fact, well, we'll get to the Isaiah 53 in just a second, but we started, remember, with Psalms 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not one of all of His amazing benefits, who forgives all my iniquities, and what?
Heals
what?
All my
diseases. You know, all scripture is given by inspiration. So God inspired that statement. When you understand God inspired it, you can't come along and say, yes, but. Listen, you can't add the but to it. I'm tempted to have some jokes along these lines, like get the butt out of there or anything like that, but I'm not going to. But the key of it is, you can't add to or diminish when God, it's God that spoke this. So our experiences is not what establishes the truth. The Word of God establishes our truth. And we've got to find how to get our experiences lining up and so that we're experiencing in our real life what the Word has declared that is ours. Now, there are issues we've got to deal with. We'll get to those in a minute. Then we went to Isaiah 53. Let me give you the picture of Isaiah 53. We primarily use verses 4 and 5. Here is the overall picture of Isaiah 53. Prophesying of Jesus, Yahshua, our Messiah, coming, our Redeemer. Because in the garden, everything that man walked in the light and the glory of God. When they surrendered their authority to Satan introduced everything that's in his dark realm. He introduced sickness, disease, sin. He brought all of this in. So what Jesus did, and this is the thing we've got to get in our hearts, everything that the enemy imprisoned us with, Jesus set us free.
Amen.
Amen? Amen? So many times we're imprisoned, not only with sin, iniquities, and transgressions, but we're also trapped in pains and griefs and infirmities and sickness and disease. Things that just have burdened us down. Things that attempt to get our minds not to even function right. Jesus, so we can't come along and say, well, now that only meant spiritual healing. Remember, we dealt with that. I took you to Matthew 8, when it says, I think it's verse 16, 17, or along, that Jesus went about healing all that were sick in order to fulfill what Isaiah said, that I would carry your sickness, I would carry your infirmities, I would carry your sorrow. So he said, I'm going about healing the very sicknesses of the people in order to fulfill what Isaiah prophesied. I'm the fulfillment of that. of God.
Healing.
He went out and over healing. Many times it says he healed everyone that was there. They would bring people to him. He would heal them. We spent a lot of time. Also Matthew 9, the first 8 verses was the other one. And this is such an amazing thing with a paralytic. And Jesus said to him, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Well, they all get an alarm. Hey, only God can forgive sins. And he said, "So that you may know that I am the Messiah," I'm putting this as my term, "that was prophesied in Isaiah 53. I not only have the power to forgive, I have the power to heal. In order that you may know that I do have the power to forgive, I say to this man, arise up and walk." He just got up and walked away. Yep. Literally proving that healing was a part of that atonement process. When Jesus went to the whipping stake, to the crucifixion stake, and to death, he took everything that Satan tried to entrap us and imprison us with, and he set us free. So we got to get that. That is our foundation in which we are going to build what we believe about healing. Are y'all with me? Are we good with that foundational stone that's been planted? Okay. Praise the Lord. Now, I want to deal with something this morning. And it has to do with the Word. Make a note of this. The Word of God is the most powerful force in the earth. The Word of God is the most powerful force in the earth when you believe it.
Amen.
Now, you can't just say what the Word says when you don't believe it and see something happen. It requires your faith, your absolute confidence, because the enemy's going to come and he's going to try every way he can to convince you. You can't have that. So you got to know. That's why I'm saying this is such a bedrock foundation we got to have. But whatever Aunt Susie says or whatever, it doesn't matter. Excuse me. I'm basing what I believe on the Word of God. And that only, just the Word of God. So many scriptures, but I want to. Go look with me in Mark 9:23. Just for a second. Just Mark 9:23. We're going to jump off here. You know, this is the story of the boy that was throwing himself in the fire, and the father took him to the disciples, and they couldn't cast him out. And they brought him to them, to Jesus. And Jesus said unto him, verse 23, "If you can believe, all things are possible to the one that believes." Say this with me. All things are possible for me when I believe the Word. Say it again. All things are possible for me when I believe the Word of God. Now, in this same chapter, is it chapter 9? I didn't even write it down. That's okay. You know these stories. I want to share 2 stories with you as we get into this. Both are very well known. We've preached them dozens, if not 100 times. One is the story of the centurion. Now, the centurion came to Jesus and he said, "My servant is sick." And Jesus, what was his response? "Well, I'll come. I'll come to your house. I'll lay hands on him. He'll be sick." He said, "Oh, no. I'm not worthy to come to my house. But all All you need to do is to speak the word. Now, I want you to notice something here, but what he was saying. See, many times, what we're reaching for something that's more evidence to grab a hold of. The fact that many times we say, Jesus, if you would just come in later, I mean, we want to feel the touch. Do you understand? I mean, because we're struggling with thinking, he said, I don't need your touch. I need your word. Now, this is an incredible statement for us when, what do you think we need? Well, I'm not being critical of anyone. I'm trying to make a point. We don't have to have 100 people praying for us.
Yes, amen.
What we need is the word and believing what the word said, whether we've got 1 or 100 to come into agreement. But my point is, there's nothing significant about having 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 people praying with you. That's not, you could have an agreement with one and have more power than 1,000 could bring to you. Is my point. Because it's the word that changes everything, it's not the touch. Which the Holy Spirit then took me to a second story, and that was even more significant to me, and that was the story of the woman with the issue of blood.
How do you feel?
What she said was, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, probably the edge of his prayer shawl, but if I can just touch the edge of it, stand up just for a second. Touch what you would not. Okay. So here's this woman. And did she have a great need?
Yes.
How many years has she been plagued with this? 12 years. Long years. Has she gone to the doctors?
Yes.
Has she spent everything she had?
Yes.
Has she tried everything she could?
Yes.
Yeah. There was nothing. So you would think, here comes. Now all she has watched him do this one time is lay hands on people. Okay? So you would think, God came to lay hands on me. There's got to be something he can bring to me. She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I'm going to be well. Okay? Now get hold of this. She wasn't looking for some dramatic move of God to somehow break her free from this sin. She began, her faith got real. All things are possible to the one that believes. She was believing, and she said, all I've got to do is touch the hem. Now, I want y'all, if you're making notes, make some notes of this. This is an incredible insight the Holy Spirit gave me yesterday. We don't have to have a scripture that says, or a word from God that says, Monty, I am right now healing your back. Okay? Well, that'd be awesome. I mean, I love those kinds of things, but we don't have to have a specific word directed to you by name declaring the thing that you're asking God to heal is healed. We don't need that. You don't even need Isaiah 53. You don't have to have a specific scripture that outlines to you that God gave you healing. Do you know you can be healed with John 3:16? You know you can be healed reading the begats in Matthew 1? You don't have to go into the very heart of the word and dig deep in there and get some amazing. All you got to do is touch the word.
Amen.
Touch it at what might not even appear to be a significant verse dealing with what you're believing for. But the power of the word is so amazing, it's so great, that even then, if you would say, listen, if I could just turn the page of the Bible and get a verse in my life, I'm not going to be If you believe that, we receive healing. The key is, he's wanting us to come to a place that, where we're not demanding a great move of God or a revelation that suddenly just breaks through our barrier. We have it. It's called the Word. That Word is more powerful than we've ever dreamed, we've ever imagined. So let's go a little bit deeper. Do you know that there's more word than that's here?
Yes.
Do you know that there is, go with me, the very last chapter of the Gospels, John chapter 21. The last two verses of the very last chapter of the last Gospel of the Gospels. I just want you to understand something. We have not yet tapped into the vast resource of this Word. It's got so many more benefits than we've even dreamed of. We can read Psalms 103 over and over, all the benefits, and yet the benefits, I believe, somewhere deep into the eons of eternity, we're still going to be discovering, just as we will discover grace, we're going to discover all the things that God had given to us. And the ways we could have walked in victory where we were still walking in some way of defeat. But in these last two verses of John chapter 21, 24 and 25, this is the disciple who testifies of these things and wrote these things. And we know that his testimony is true. Everything I've written about the Messiah is true in the Word. And there are so And there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. The vastness of what Jesus did, and we sometimes, as the church, we want to just stay locked into just one simple revelation that we're saved and we're going to heaven. There is so much more that needs to be unlocked. There's so much more victory that he wants us to walk in. There is much more that the Word of God can do in our lives. There are things that are happening in this world that if we understood the Word, we could change some of the things that are taking place in the earth. Do you believe that we could change the climate issue? What is called global warming? We see things. Do you think that we have any authority there? We think we do. Let me just declare, I'm still in this thing of the Word. Everything that was created, you see this in John 1, the first three verses of John chapter 1. Everything that was created by the Word. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. And in the beginning, nothing that was made that wasn't made by the Word. So, when Jesus, or when God spoke, he spoke the Word. And Jesus came as that Word released into the earth to demonstrate what that Word would do. So when we go back to that last two verses of John, and it said, I can't tell you everything that Jesus did. What did he come to do? He came to unlock us, to set us free from everything the enemy has us bound with. He came to reveal Father's heart. He came to reveal what the Word is capable of doing. And he went about teaching his disciples how to bring that Word into a place that it's effective. Praise the Lord. I had extra time today, and I don't know what to do with it. I'm always used to being rushed, and I got time to say all that. go there for a minute. First three verses. Faith is what? So faith is substance. So in verse 3, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word. They were formed. They came into existence by the Word. By the Word of God. So that the things which are seen were not made with things which are visible. Okay. You see, some people have said God created out of nothing. That's a total misstatement. Miss Mary shared recently that when you create, you have to create from a substance. That's what creation means. What's the substance? The Word. His Word is the substance. So that our faith then is on the substance of the Word. And when we rely on something that has more substance than what's in the natural realm, because the natural realm says, well, He would, in order to create the world, he would have had to have created it from dirt. It's kind of like the old joke about God and Satan in a war, and Satan saying, I can do anything you can do. And he said, all right, create man. So he gets down and he's going to start forming from the dust. And God says, no, that's my dust. I made that. We have to make your own. You know? Everything he used to create came from his Word, which became the greatest of all substance. You need to write that down. His Word, not only is it the greatest force or greatest power, it is the greatest substance. Because you got, in order to have faith, you've got to have substance. I'll deal with that in a little bit here as we get a little deeper into it. Go with me to Hebrews 1, verse 3. We'll just skip right to it. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. I bet you David can find it before I can. Speaking of Jesus, speaking of Yeshua, speaking of the Word, being the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person. Now, we're just going to stop here for a second. Any of y'all remember the revelation I gave you of this word person? Anybody remember it? Really important. It's the same word as substance in Hebrews 11, 1. Isn't that amazing? His person is the substance. The substance is His person. It is. Because you can't separate the Word from who He is. It's the thing that why you can rely on His Word, because you can rely on Him. He's not a God that would ever let you down. He's a God that would never say something and it not be true. You can always rely upon what He says. Because it's the substance is the very person of God Himself. But notice this next line. This is very important. Upholding all things by the word of His power when He Himself had purged our sin. Literally, everything in the worlds, all of the universe, everything. See, what scientists and everyone wants you to believe is that there are laws that have been established and they keep this universe working. There are laws that keep our earth working. But I want to tell you something. That's not what controls what happens in the earth or what happens in the universe. It's the Word that holds it all together, that keeps everything functioning the way it's supposed to. So that if there was a time that you needed to do something that went against the natural laws, the Word, the supernatural realm, could give you the authority to do something that's out of the realm of the natural. I mean, how many of you could take, I don't see anybody with a coat, take your coat and go down to the San Antonio River and slide it, and it would part. Did anyone ever do that? Not in San Antonio, right? But did anybody ever take their coat or mantle and strike a river and it part? Sure. Elijah had done it before him. Two had done it. I mean, how do you make an axe head made of iron to float? How can you make the sun to stand still? Now, come on, guys. Let's get out of our small thinking here. I'm saying, if we're walking in agreement with the one that upholds all of this, and what did he teach? He taught Peter how to walk on water. How did Peter walk on the water? Because Jesus gave him the word. Come. He stepped out on that word, come, and he was walking on that word right on top of the storm and the water until his natural mind started kicking in. Now, wait a minute. I read about this law. I shouldn't be able to do this. How many of you would agree? Should not be able to do it. But see, there's authority in the word to do things in the natural that the natural says you can't do. Even my doctor told me, he said, because I told him, I said, my back is getting healed. He said, Monty, your back cannot get healed. Okay, what was he saying? No, he said, no, there's a law here. Well, he wouldn't say that, but I mean, what do you mean? He said, there's a law going on here that when I fell and I have a vertebrae sticking up through a disc. Okay? And, I looked at him and I said, well, that might be true, but I couldn't do it. A few months ago.
Right. Amen.
I couldn't. There were just so many things I couldn't do. You told me you don't want me to lift anything heavier than a bottle of water. Mm-hmm. I've been lifting things just like I've always lifted. Mm-hmm. I don't have any issues. Other than just lifting. I mean, there's times you're doing something and you're. If I had never hosed this, my back would have still been bothering me after doing that. You understand? Because there are laws that are above the laws in the natural realm that says herniated discs do not get better, period. You have to have surgery. You got to have to do, there's certain things you're going to have to do in order for that to get better. No. There is this thing that most people don't know. You can speak the word to it. You can declare the word to it, and it has to respond if I will believe it. Okay? I'm just so that you know, I'm about halfway done. I have to put those in. So our words, they need to carry some substance if they're going to work. How do you get substance into your words? Well, one of the things you can do, you can go to school and learn about all the scientific laws and have your, so that your words now are based on everything that the natural laws tell you, and you're going to say, no, you cannot be healed. I cannot be healed unless I had surgery. Okay? That's substance. Hang with me, guys. You're looking like you're puzzled. Because your words cannot, you have three possibilities with your words. Three possibilities. One, your word can align with the Word of God. And whatever the Word of God says, that's what you're declaring, and you put your faith in it, you put your hope and confidence in it, and you declare it because you believe it, that becomes substance, and your life is being controlled by a substance called faith in the Word of God.
Amen.
Or you can have faith in the natural one. It's still faith. You can have faith based on fear of all the bad things that are going to happen. And you can be, I mean, I've heard people say, I've been worried about this and worried about it, and it came to pass. Yeah. Well, of course it did. You aided that coming to pass. Well, I'm not going to say you caused it, but you certainly were a part of it coming. The very difficulty you knew was going to happen is going to happen because your confidence. See, one of our problems is we are in another prison that God, that Jesus came to bring us from, and that is the prison of being controlled by logic and natural thinking. You're quiet. You're very quiet. Okay. I'm going somewhere. Oh, I said three things. Your words can have the substance of the Word, the substance basically of the world or the natural realm, or it can have no substance at all. And just been saying useless, meaningless things that have no value, that don't cause anything to happen. And the scripture in Matthew says, you're going to be held accountable for those useless, worthless words that you did. Because people just say stuff. People just say stuff. They say, well, I don't mean it that way. You're just saying stuff. We've got to get to where our words carry some substance. So, I'm waiting to get to another scripture, but I want to say something to you. You have to know the natural world is not controlled by the natural world. Hang on to that, Bill. The natural world is controlled by the supernatural realm of God. Do you know that even kings and presidents and all this are controlled by God? He sets people up. He sets people down. There is a flow. I mean, people can sit back and say, I don't know how this person got into that position. It's impossible. And many times, it is impossible. Unless God is decreeing it. Unless God is... There are times... Listen, there is so much sickness and disease running loose in our world today that if it wasn't for what God had given us in our authority, what is being spoken to break the power of sickness, there are sicknesses and diseases in our world today that have no cure. Some of them, they've come up with some horrible sounding names for chikungunya or something, I mean, they're just some, but have you ever noticed, they will say, we're going to have a plague, it's going to sweep across the world, and it's contained down in the Caribbean and never leaves. How? Because the natural world doesn't control the natural world. I'm not sure I've got you convinced yet. Because if it did, we probably wouldn't be here. This place would have come unraveled years ago. It's being held together by the Word of God.
Amen.
And by our words that come into agreement with that Word.
Amen.
Okay. Now go with me to Matthew 21. Are y'all hanging with me?
Yes.
Everybody?
Yes.
Well, this is an awesome passage. We're going to begin in verse 18 of Matthew 21. Now, I normally read this out of Mark 11 because I love Mark 11. I kind of go with Pop Hagen. You should never preach without at least referring to Matthew 11, 23 through 24. But this is Matthew's version of the same story. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he was hungry. So the disciples, we did something.
18.
And he said, no, wait, wait.
18.
No, no, no.
18.
We're going all over the
place. Where are we at? 18.
Verse 18, and then 19. Yeah, okay, now go to 19.
There we go.
And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves, and said, let no fruit grow on you forever. And immediately, say immediately.
Immediately.
Say instantly.
Instantly.
Right away.
Right away.
The fig tree withered away. Now, what is the natural law concerning trees to wither and die? It would take a while. I mean, what can you do? You could put poison on a tree and it would take maybe at least 48 hours for it to start feeling the effects of the poison and die. You can withhold water and that would take weeks before it, I mean, it would start to get bad after a period of time. But not immediately. What can change a natural object immediately? The Word. The Word can change things immediately. Go to verse 20. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how did this fig tree? Now, they understood something about some natural laws. This doesn't make sense. How is this possible that it withered away so soon? So Jesus answered and said, assuredly, say that word with me, assuredly, know for certain, be guaranteed of this. I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done in this fig tree, but if you say to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, it will be done. In one scripture, it actually said it would have to obey you. Do you ever think in terms of trees obeying you? some weeks now, and it says, I try not to stop and I say, God, this is good. Why you're trouble? Because I know something about trouble. I've shared it. See, God's not raising up one, He's raising us all up. And if we're going to be able to change the course that the enemy has for San Antonio, we're going to have to know these things. Because if we don't know them, the very first time we get into an encounter, we're going to be backed away because we weren't in a position of strength, of knowing. I'm here because of the Word of God is established in my heart, and I'm going to do what the Word of God says. I'm going to declare it, and I'm going to see every opposition back away, and I'm coming through, and the glory of God is going to come. That what I'm preaching today can't be preached.
Amen.
You know, I've always, I gotta be careful because I don't want to chase a rabbit here, but I've always been convinced the reason some people are martyred is because they didn't know what I'm teaching you today. See, I've always said, when Jesus said, no man can take my life unless I give it, He was establishing a law for us, a way for us. You know, if someone comes and say, you know, you're going to deny Jesus or I'm blowing your head off, I say, I'm not denying Jesus, and you're not blowing my head off. I don't give you the authority to do it. I bind whatever power you think you have to take my life, I bind it. And I'm not about to be afraid of what you're about or trying to do because I do not give you the authority to do it. Now, I'm telling you, that's what Jesus is teaching. You understand? Let's go a little further with this. Okay, go to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. We're gonna speed through this one just a little bit to get to the part that I want. But in Luke chapter 10, verse 1. After these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also, and sent them two by two before His face into every city and place where He Himself was about to go. So He's sending out these 70s. I love verse 3. He says, go your way. Behold, I'm sending you out as lambs among wolves. The reason, I'll give a great illustration of a lamb amongst wolves, David and Goliath. While we may look weak, while we may look, you're an insignificant group of people in an insignificant little part of San Antonio. You are no threat to me. Why are you even coming out to bother me? You don't know. What we look like on the outside is not what we look like on the inside. You're not just looking at someone that looks meek and mild, but what we got inside is the power, the greatest force that's in the world today, and that's the Word of God in you. I'm going to walk in victory because of what the Word is declaring that I can do. Scared to death of you, is it? Remember what the demoniac in the Gathering said to Jesus? Are you here to persecute us before our time? Listen, they understand, they recognize authority. The enemy recognizes authority, guys. What the enemy doesn't recognize is when your authority is weak. And you're not walking in it. You're not sure of it. You're not sure of what you can do. And you've been taught all your life, well, certain things just can't. There's no way you can walk on water. There's no way you can curse a victory and it would die. But I'm telling you, if that is, listen, there have been missionaries all over the world that have come up against situations of flooded rivers and have walked across the rivers. I have a book Verse 9. What he sent them out to do was to heal the sick and to say to them, the kingdom of heaven is come near to you. The kingdom of God has come near to you.
Amen.
Literally, he is sending us out, church. We are being sent out into the world, and he says you're going out as a lamb among wolves, but you're going out with the full authority of the kingdom of God. And when you come into a place and there's a difficulty, you tell them, hey, no fear. It's not because I'm here. It's because the kingdom of God is here. I'm here. I represent the kingdom of God. I believe everything about the kingdom of God, and I come with the authority of the king and the word of the king, and I'm here to turn whatever has been a problem in your life, we're going to turn it around. And we're going to see God give victory after victory after victory after victory. Okay. Verse 17. Then the 70 returned with joy. Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And he said to them, now this is so cool. As they're saying this, he said, yeah, I know. I'm watching you guys. I'm watching what's happening. And as you were casting out demons, I saw Satan fall from the place of the heaven. Now, remember, he gives us the keys of the kingdom, and we can bind and loose the things in heaven. This is not where God is. This is the heavens where the enemy has been ruling and reigning. In the heavenly realm, where the principalities of the earth, the heavenlies are. So we can bind what goes on there, and we can loose what goes on there. So what Jesus said, while you were out releasing the kingdom of God, I saw Satan fall. I saw Satan losing his place. Now, listen. Man, this is so incredible. This is before the cross. This is before Jesus took Satan and drove him across the sands of time and made an open show of him and defeated him. So before Jesus took Satan down, here were these disciples. All they had was the word. The word that says, go, tell the kingdom of God is here, heal the sick. And they're out there going, and here comes Satan crashing down from his position in the heavenlies. It's not over. Not over. Come on, this is so good. He said, behold, I give you authority. Say it, I have authority. I can trample on serpents and on scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. I'll say it stronger. And over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt me. Woo! Now that's the word being released before the cross. Now hang on. What do you think we got today? When now we get to be more than the conqueror. We get to step into what he has already accomplished and completely defeated sin. Now he's not even up there in a place of authority other than the authority we give him. His only right to be in that place is if we give him that place.
Yeah.
If we take it from him, guess what happens to him?
Amen.
He crashes down. You keep going. There's still more. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that your spirits are subject, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice that, what? Your names, this is not written in the book of the Lamb of God. They couldn't be, because he hasn't gone to the cross. So this is not about being born again and getting your names written in the Lamb's book of God. He says, notice, your names are written in the very place that Satan just fell from.
This is
world.
From the dark.